All right, so let's do some context setting here for a minute. So again, remind me who's first time startup grind. Let me see. Okay, great. So tell us how many of you are founders so we know who are talking to corporate owners. Great. Okay. How many people play in the angel or VC world? Some people? Okay, awesome. Great, so how many of you are Mac versus PC? Who are Mac people? All right, PC? All right, about evenly split. iPhone, let me see my iPhone people. Okay, Android. All right, so there's some context. Yeah. That's who we're talking to.
So I've got a little bit of John Hodgkins and Justin Long, right?
I think so, right?
Versus PC.
Wait, do you have Microsoft phones out there? Nokia. Okay, just checking. Just trying to be like equally inclusive. They might be. And you're going to tell us about that, right? Because that's really where your background is and can't wait to hear that. So with that, like, how did you get here? Like, as a little kid, did you think you were going to be here? Like, is this played out the way you thought it was going to?
No.
As it usually
Should
does.
I elaborate?
Yeah, maybe just a little bit. Yeah.
Well, I grew up on a farm out in the Pickers in northern Michigan. I actually was an entrepreneur as a little kid, though, because I started growing plants, seedlings, and I would sell them in town. So, you know, because it was the whole where did your entrepreneurship thing start? Well, I actually started when I was a kid. So I ended up at the University of Michigan, and I got lucky. I stumbled across this research group, and they were building design tools for very large, fail-safe, real-time systems like air traffic control, missile guidance, factory floor automation, interbank financial transfer, stuff like that. So I'm old. This was back in the days of the mainframe. So I was lucky in that group in that I got to see sort of the transition to the PC. We got the first IBM PCs in there. We started building tools for those. It was really cool. So what happened, though, is people all over the world were using those tools, even though they were part of a research group. So right when I was graduating, we spun out a startup to support those tools worldwide and to commercialize them. So that was my first startup, was out of the university. We licensed software from the Regents, and the chair of the department and some of his students went off and started this company.
Did you think, like when you were a kid, like when you were growing up, like did you have a lemonade stand, a paper route? Like what was the first thing? Like I love this question by
plants,
Mike. Like how did you make your first dollar?
Plant sales. Yeah.
What was your favorite like go-to plant? What was it?
Oh, back then?
Yeah.
Oh God, it was probably petunias or something like really pedestrian because that's what we had. Now it's something different, but back then it was probably petunias.
Did your parents look at you like, oh, that's our little entrepreneur? Did you always think?
You know, they just kind of let me do what I wanted. I was the third of four kids, and I had a way older brother and sister who grew up in the 60s, and by the time I got there, my parents were like, whatever.
Just going to let Serena do what Serena does.
Yeah, you know, they were very supportive. You know, they were kind of let me do whatever I wanted to do. So it worked out.
Was there a moment, right, where you're like, I want to be an entrepreneur or a business owner, or I don't want to work for, I mean, you can characterize that, right, as corporate or whatever. Did you always think you wanted to be a business owner, or did you think that,
you know,
how did that look
I
for
didn't,
you?
No, I didn't think about it that way so much. I didn't feel like, oh, I can't go work for a large corporation. In fact, I would encourage entrepreneurs to do that because from time to time, because I think it's good to get that experience. But for me, it was more, I just need to get the heck out of this little town. Like, I need to go do something. Like, the world's really cool. I'd had an opportunity to travel, and I'm like, I got to get out of here. So that was really what was on my mind. And then, you know, partly with luck, I stumbled into this research group, and then I just loved doing the startup thing, and it was really fun.
So you went from out of Michigan into startup, and then tell me how you got to Microsoft.
Well, so I was in the startup. So in the 80s, basically, we were building design tools for very large systems, and I was partly in Ann Arbor and partly in various parts of the world. I worked mostly in Europe, lived in Italy, so forth. I came back to Ann Arbor to go to grad school because I realized I was a tech head and didn't know anything about.
How long were you traveling? Like, what was that when you were just in Europe? How long were you in Europe when you were traveling?
I lived there for a couple years, and then I went back and forth for probably that whole decade. Okay. Then decided to go back to grad school because back in, I didn't like know anything about balancing. I could barely balance a checkbook. So it's like, okay, I need some, I need some accounting skills. I need some marketing skills. So I went back to, in those days, the thing to do was to go get an MBA. So that's what I did. And because I had been writing tools already for Windows 2.0, during that time, I knew about Microsoft. It was still pretty early, but in grad school, I went and I spent the summer in Rome, Italy, selling toothpaste for P&G because I wanted to find out whether or not I could do something besides software, you know, because that's all I'd ever done was tech, and I hated it. It was so boring. And so that was a great summer because I realized, okay, I'm not going to do consumer marketing. I want to go back to tech, and so Microsoft, for me, was the place I wanted to be.
I love this question. Like, how many people are product people versus tech people? Product people, product. Look around at your product people, right? Because these people are very different than tech people. Raise your hand, right? It's very, very different as founders. So, and how you meet those people, super important. So look at those people and say hello throughout the night, but that's a very different thing.
Yeah.
In how you look at it.
Yeah, it is very different. But I knew I wanted to be in the technology space, but I wanted to be able to build businesses. And so I spent the 90s at Microsoft and ran a number of product groups. I founded with a couple other people MSDN, which is the developer network. And that was cool because that was entrepreneurship. It was inside of Microsoft. And they're like, it was 91. They're like, we have a huge dev problem. They hate us. Fix it.
It's like an MSDN member. Like, I remember, like, something
for
MSDN.
Yeah, no, totally. Like, totally. It was like, fix this MSDN problem, members? And they handed us this itty-bitty, tiny little budget, and we're like, really? Is that all you're giving us? And basically, we had to go. There was a small group of us, and we went and fixed the problem. And it was really cool because it was very, very entrepreneurial, but it was inside of a big company, and we broke everything because we were the first subscription that they ever produced. We were the first thing on CD-ROM. So it was just, like, they hated us because we broke every system inside the company. So that was fun. And then I did, I loved it.
That's called entrepreneurship right there. Yeah, breaking everything inside the company, entrepreneurship.
Entrepreneurship, yeah. We busted everything, but it was really fun. And so I ran several other product groups, dev teams, but then I got a chance to do M&A for a couple of years. So I got pulled aside working for one of the VPs to basically do business development. And that was very interesting because that's where I met my later co-founders. So we were back in acquisition mode and at that time at Microsoft, and so we were buying companies left and right, and so I got to see the
this
buy
is like,
side
this is
of
what
M&A.
Year? Like, where are we at? Like
95,
okay.
Yeah, 95, got to see the buy side of M&A, which was really cool. Met some great people, which is partly why I do this. And so that was a very, very interesting learning experience. And during that period, too, I got to really see the PC evolution and then into the web. So there's these sea changes going on from mainframe to PC to the web. And then in the not decade, after we had left, a lot of us had left Microsoft, myself and several other ex-Microsoft folks founded a company called Twango, which you probably never heard of. That company we sold 3.5 years later to Nokia. And so the great thing from that was we learned mobile in a big way because we were Microsoft people, we didn't know anything about mobile. So, you know, Nokia in 2007 was, you know, at the top of the game, number one brand in Asia, number five brand in the world, and amazing research groups, and so we learned a ton there. So that was very interesting. Learned a lot about Finnish culture. So that was kind of my transition into mobile. And during that time and before that, at Microsoft, I had been angel investing on the side because everybody was leaving Microsoft and starting a company, and they're like, hey, will you write me a check? And I'm like, sure. No stress.
Will you write me a check? Can we sell it? No. Can we sell that conversation?
No. I've learned the hard way.
Mike, I'm out of here. So the only reason I was here was to write for a check.
Absolutely no portfolio theory whatsoever. But that's how, in fact, a lot of angels sort of start that way. They really do. I mean, you talk to a lot of angels that are like, yeah, I wrote a few checks from some of my old buddies. Oh, my God, that was a mistake. But I really loved it. I started really loving it. And so after we left Nokia, I started angel investing, and it just gradually turned from a very part-time thing into a very full-time thing, which is what I do now.
So when you look at, let's say, like, go all the way back again to, we're back in Michigan, right, before Microsoft, and how do you look at whether it be companies you want to join, like, why did you decide on Microsoft, and what is similar in how you look at what you want, who you want to invest in a company, like, what stayed the same, or what do you look at as a, I think this is a, something that I look for in every company, and if it doesn't have this, it's out. And you've known that for a long time, and it's proved to be true for you. What does that look like?
Wow. Well, there's a number of different ways I look at it. First of all, I tend to focus on things I know. So, for example, I don't invest in clean energy because I don't know jack about LED battery technology.
I take offense to that. Like, really? We could not know Mike about that. Jack is not cool. It's not cool. Don't do that.
Sorry. I don't know anything.
Okay, there we better.
I don't know nothing about LED battery technology. No, so I tend, for the most part, to stay away from stuff I don't know, because I feel like I'm going to be a smarter investor if I have half a clue about what these guys are doing. So that's number one. Number two, I tend to mostly invest in stuff I'm passionate about. Now, sometimes I'll write checks for people I know who I think are brilliant, and I know them, and it's maybe not an area of interest, but for the most part, I stick to stuff that I'm interested in personally. There's a number of themes that I have in my portfolio. One of them is, and we've, you know, Stacey has started talking about it already tonight, I look for diversified companies. And if they're not diversified, I talk to them before I invest about getting diversified.
So are we talking diversification in leadership or
yes,
staff or product
yes.
or all of the above?
No.
Like, what does that mean to
people.
You?
People.
Okay.
People. And what that typically means in this space is lack of women. And so, but I don't, if it's an all-woman company, the first thing I say is, where's your dude? Because you need one, right? So very, very important. And I mean, you can, there's 1,000 studies on this now. I don't need to go through them, but diversified companies outperform non-diversified companies across the board, full stop. It's the right thing to do from a financial perspective for a portfolio, if you're managing a portfolio. It's also ethically or morally the right thing to do. So I look for that, and if the company doesn't have it, I help them get it. That's really important to me. The other thing I look at a lot, not for all of my companies, but for a lot of my companies, it's hard to explain without going into a whole, I'd have to explain my whole philosophy for how we should measure success in the world, but basically I look for companies that are doing something that's adding value to the world. And that doesn't mean necessarily drilling wells in Africa. It could mean things, because I have an operations background, I look for a lot of companies where they're solving inefficiencies in the market. So
what are some examples where you have invested in companies where you think that is success, or if they achieve what they want is success?
Yeah,
what are some
totally.
Specific
I'll
examples?
Give you an example.
Yeah.
So it's companies where there are inefficiencies, and particularly where women are the customer, because women as a customer are often ignored, and there's an arbitrage opportunity there, because a lot of people they look at companies and they go, oh, that's for moms, that's not very interesting. And actually the reality is women with kids spend more time on device than anybody else. 80% of purchase decisions are made by women. I mean, I could just go on and on with the data. So I look at it and go, huge opportunity for me looking at it from a women's perspective. Anybody who's investing as a woman or building companies, thinking about that audience. So examples of that are, I have this theme, clean out my garage. It's a mess. So I'm in a company called Offer Up. That's where I sell all my crap, right?
Going to get there, for sure.
We're gonna get there, right? So
just that little tiny billion-dollar company OfferUp thing.
Well,
like,
and there's
you know,
a way bigger play there, but
yes,
I'm just talking about,
wait to
you know,
hear. Yeah.
It's like, okay, I can get rid of my stuff, great. I'm in Livable, which is where I store my stuff. I don't have to go to those icky, huge storage sheds on the side of the road anymore and spend $195 a month. I can spend $25 a month and have them come and get my nice little boxes and take them away. Love it. I'm also in Ghost Truck. And again, utilization of resources, you know, trucks deadheading all over the place on the road. How can we better utilize those? Less and less people are going to have vehicles to haul stuff around in. So trucking services to especially things like furniture, to move furniture. So those are just examples. And in fact, all three of those companies really are an ecosystem that we're trying to bring together to take care of all that crap in the garage. So people can downsize. You know, there's a huge trend to downsizing. A lot of people living in the city in small apartments. Where do they put all their skateboards and their bikes and their skis and all that junk that they don't need every day? You know, off seasonal stuff. So that's an example of things that I think are good for the world, good for people. They can live better in the space they're in. They can consume less resources. I want to get rid of all the cheap plastic crap out of the landfills. So, I mean, there's just all kinds of things that you can start to make happen if you allow point-to-point, consumer-to-consumer, very efficient flow of goods. You know, all of a sudden, manufacturers are going to want to build better stuff. People will pay more because they know they can resell it later when they're done with it. You know, I'm thinking strollers and cribs and cars and all kinds of stuff. So those are some of the examples that I have of do-good kind of companies. I mean, another example is Luis Salazar's company, Jobaline, and his, again, the dollar an hour, you know, the hourly wage, low-income workers, like at Walmart, McDonald's, and so on, those jobs turn over really fast. It's super expensive for companies to find and keep employees, and it's very, very hard for those low-income or low-wage employees to find jobs. And so he's got this really slick mobile app that makes it way easier for that marketplace to flow. Yeah, so those are some examples.
Awesome. Any questions about how she got on the stage, right? Some amazing things, right, that she's done, right? Absolutely amazing, talented. I'm curious when, do you have a question? I'm gonna go question for a minute, so I don't, are we good for a minute? All right, so Microsoft to Twango. When did you say, like, it's time to go? Like, how did you know that? Because that was garage, right? That's the story.
Yeah, basement. Right?
Yeah, basement. So you're like, was it going on while you're at Microsoft? Like, what was the point where you said?
Two separate decisions.
Yeah, where you're like, I'm done here, and I want to do this. And what made you take the leap?
Yeah, so, and it's a point that I make to startup people often when they ask, but two separate decisions. I mean, Microsoft is awesome. I was there through the 90s. I loved the place. It was a nightmare as a woman there, but I still love the place. I met a million great people. I learned a ton. But I got to the point where it was like, okay, I'm done with big companies. I believe that, you know, fixing some of these problems that Stacia brought up earlier, especially for women, it's better, it's easier to build companies from the ground up and build diversified companies than it is to try to change big companies that already have a very set culture that's been there for, in that case, you know, a couple decades. So, somebody say amen. Did I just hear an amen?
Some thumbs up on building new companies, right? Values, like, culture, women, right? All that?
Right. Yeah. And, you know, younger women, a lot of times, they look at me and go, I've not had so many problems. Why are you so bitter about all the... I'm like, because I've been doing this for 36 years, and I've been, like, looked over, beat up, told to get the coffee so many times, right? You, if you're younger, maybe you haven't had that many problems, but the blocks are there. They are definitely there, and the data shows that. So it's like, okay, do you try to fix the big companies, which people are doing, which is great? I chose to start from scratch, which is why, one of the big reasons why I do what I do, because I think it's better to build them from the ground up. And I think innovation happens better in small companies than in large companies, by and large, as well. So that was the reason for leaving.
So talk, like, what was that conversation like for you, right? Because some people still have jobs, right? Or have a startup and a job, right? Making that jump is a lot. As a female founder, it's another thing, right? Like, what was the conversation? Was that
leaving?
Who was your support? Who was your mentor? Like, how did you have that conversation with yourself to you're like, this is going to be something that I want to do?
The leaving part.
I think,
or the starting, because they're two different things.
You take that however you want and how you broke that up for yourself. And like, if you were going to tell someone who's like, I'm thinking about leaving my job for a startup, what are some things they should think about that you thought about?
Yeah. Okay. So there's a couple things I would say. First of all, you know, success in this space is, you know, you got to have some talent. You got to work really, 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 really hard. That's why they call it a grind. Yeah. And you're kidding yourself if you don't think it's part luck. Like, anybody who tells you, it's not bullshit. It's part luck.
I was very lucky. I happened to be in the right place at the right time in the 90s. I worked hard, I had fun, and I was able to leave. So that was part of it. It's like, okay, I feel like I've done my run here, I've learned a ton, I'm not worried about the paycheck next week, I can afford to take that leap. So I did. The more interesting question, though, is the, do I start a company? That's the really big question. And what, you know, I think some things to think about is, one is, if you're gonna do it, it's an all-in thing. There's no part-time, part-way, unless you're just doing a little lifestyle thing on the side. If you're doing that, that's fine. Don't take anybody else's money. But if you're gonna go for it, it is, you gotta go for it. It's an all-in thing, so it's like figuring that out, you know, making that decision to go for it is a big decision, and I remember thinking about it. The other part of it I think is really important is passion. Like, don't go for it unless you're really passionate about what you're doing, because you're gonna work really, 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 really hard, and I think you'll do better if you have some passion around what you're working on. And so for me, it was, you know, in 2004, we were all sitting in my living room talking, should we do this, should we not do this? We were exploring all these ideas, and we knew there was gonna be converged devices, and it was a social media sharing site that we built. And it was like, we saw all this stuff coming, and we're like, everybody's gonna walk around with these life recorders in their pockets, and I'm just like, yeah, and I wanna build that thing, right? And so we were passionate about it, and that was a big part of that decision, is having that passion. So don't do it unless you've got the passion. The other thing I would say as a female, since this is female month, a lot of women are afraid. And I've been that way all my life too. Some of the best advice I've gotten from people is stop being afraid, go for it. And so a lot of times what I say to women, because I mentor a lot of women, I get a lot of questions from women, it's like, stop being afraid. Stop questioning whether you can do it or not. Just go for it. Because most people who go for it only have about, you know, 30% of what it takes, and they've got to build teams around them to do the rest. Women, same thing. But a lot of women have that mentality of, I got to know how to do everything before I can even do it. Just go for it.
So is that going
to
be?
So that's the big, those are some of the big things you have to think about. And you have to think about also when you start a company, which I didn't realize until I did it, and I had 10 guys in my basement, which is a whole nother story, but, God.
Is that where they filmed Magic Mike? Is that where that was at? Like, what was going on there?
Pretty much. Okay. I had Jaeger that cooked a package of sausages in my microwave every day for lunch. It was like, oh my God, my house stinks. No.
We should tweet that. Whatever that was, we should tweet it. That social media moment right there. That's what that is.
Well, you have to understand, this is 2004. Okay, there was no iPhone. There was no app store. The way to get an app on a device was, you know, you had to get a deal with a carrier or a hardware manufacturer. Right. Yeah. It was hard. Yeah. Yeah. And there was no Impact Hub. There was no Galvanize. There was no WeWork. There was nowhere to start a company. There was no Amazon AWS either. And so the only way to start a company was to put your personal name down on three-year lease, which I was not willing to do. I'm like, I'm cleaning my basement out. So, and that was a cheap way to go. And we were lucky that we had the opportunity to do that. But I lost the thread. What was I talking about?
So we're gonna
employees. That's the other thing. You won't realize until you have employees how scary that is. Because all
how
of a
scary
sudden,
you are as a boss, right? It's a little bit of both, right?
Well, that they already knew. Yeah, well, we won't go there.
Okay. We will, but just not yet.
No, I mean, it's this really strange thing where all of a sudden, you know, and I had a bunch of UW students, like we were hiring out of the U because they were cheap labor and they worked really hard. And it's like, oh my God, like these guys need their paychecks. And all of a sudden, like if I screw up, they don't have a paycheck. So I, you know, there's this whole big, like, don't screw up, don't screw up, don't screw up. You know, it's hard. So that's something you have to think about.
So again, we're gonna go back. So out of all of those experiences, right, so many that you just talked about, the one best piece of business advice that has served you in from Michigan to now, and why, and who gave it to you? So what's your business advice that you'd like to pass on that's been amazing for you?
You know, that's a hard one to nail it down to one thing. I would say
there's a couple, right? They're gonna, yeah. They would probably love a couple.
I've already said one of them.
Yeah.
just go for it. Don't be afraid, especially females. Go for it. The other one is, and I heard it from many people along the way, is surround yourself with people who are smarter than you are and who have experience in areas that you don't. Like, don't go in thinking you know. And it's like, this is one of the things when I'm looking at companies and I'm assessing who do I invest in or who do I not invest in. It's the, you know, I look for founders who are passionate, confident, but also recognize, okay, you know, I write code, I'm not an accountant, or I'm an accountant, I don't write code. I need help here, I need help there. And they're willing to listen and bring on smart people, you know, people like you, like Mike, who's had a lot of experience. You know, if they're not willing to surround themselves with smart people, they're probably a really, really bad investment. So I think that's, you know, I've seen that, and for myself too, I'm always looking for the smartest people to put around me.
I think that's awesome. And just a tangent for just a minute. We talked about this in the back of the room. Why are you here? Right? Why are you here talking? Right? You don't have to be here talking. Why are you here talking? Because that meant a lot when you...
Because you're such a nice guy.
Well, I mean, we know that. I mean, seriously, we know that, right? But I mean, aside from that, right? In addition to that.
No. You know, it goes back to that whole luck, the comment I made about luck. I mean, I've worked super, super hard ever since I was, you know, a kid. I've always worked. But I've also been super lucky. I've been in the right place at the right time on a number of occasions. Had some things, made a lot of stupid mistakes. Back to Mike's comment. Yeah, I've made a lot of dumb mistakes, messed some things up. But I've also been lucky sometime, too, and things went my way. And so I feel like a lot of that came out of this town. You know, my success has been here, and so I feel really passionate about giving back. I want to help other people be able to do what I've done, particularly women. Because bottom line, if you're going to invest your time and your money in anything, the absolute best place to put your money is in a woman. And it doesn't matter.
That's a tweetable right there. We got that? Who's got that? Right, that's a good one.
Absolutely. Right, yeah. And the data shows it. Like over and over, it doesn't matter whether you're putting $200 into a woman in Central Africa through Grameen Bank, her return on her loan is the envy of any banker in the Western world. She not only returns that money, but she does amazing things with it, and she not only raises her lifestyle, but those of her children and her entire village. I mean, it's just phenomenal what happens when you give $200 to a woman in Africa. It's the same thing here. It's phenomenal when you give a woman or a woman-led team or a team with women on it enough money to get started with a new, cool, innovative idea. And so that's why I do what I do.
Yeah. And a female sitting out in the audience right now is thinking about starting a business, right? You're 20, you're a bunch of years past that. You've seen a lot of businesses.
I'm old.
We're old. We are old, right? We're old. What do you say, right? What do they look at, or what do they do? And I think actually, I'm gonna get specific on mentorship, because I think that's such a huge thing. And I think, you know, how has that worked out for you? How did you find your mentors? Who's guided you, and some of those things? So back to that advice and mentorship, and what do you think about that? And for men, right? What about men looking for, right, who might have an all-male board of advisors, right, or be two male co-founders, right? How do you approach women, right, to be in your business? What does that look like? Because I think that's, as a male founder, I think that's difficult for me, like, to not be like, I'm gonna make a female play to have a board of advisor, or, you know, what does that look like, if that makes any sense?
I think you asked like three questions.
I know, I had a bunch in there, didn't I?
Yeah, I'm trying to figure out like what angle you're really, like, you started with the 23-year-old, like what are they supposed to be thinking about?
Let's go 23-year-old and then work into how that plays out.
With the mentors, like how do you find mentors? Is that what you really?
Well, is that what it took for you at 23 to build your business, is to find some mentors? Or I think that's an important part. How did you do it?
So I think mentors.
Maybe that's my foundational question.
Yeah, so, you know, in all my different experiences, yeah, okay. So
We'll go there.
All right. So in all my experiences, mentors were super important for me. Like when I was at the research group in the university, I got super lucky. The chairman of the department liked me, you know, took me into the group and really helped me. So, and you know, I didn't go to him. It was just kind of just happened because I was doing research in the group. So I felt very, very fortunate. At Microsoft, I had several people who helped mentor me. Not a lot of people, and no women, unfortunately. That was a huge problem. There was Patty was the only woman, and she left. There were no women. But I did have a couple of guys who helped mentor me, and they were awesome. They like picked me up and took me with them and helped me get jobs and so forth. And in the startup world, you know, because I was already so connected in Seattle, I was able to reach out. If you're connected already in town, it's like just reach out. If you're not, you know, to people you know, and they're going to know somebody, and they're going to know somebody. If you're not connected to people, you just got to show up to things like this. I mean, and there's a bunch of these kinds of things around town. And you just got to walk up and shake people's hand and say, hey, I got this idea. I want to build XYZ. I'd love to talk to you. And you have to send emails. I mean, you just kind of got to be a salesperson. And sometimes it's hard. But once you get that first person, all it takes is one. It's like investing when you're trying to raise a round. If you can just get that one lead, Mike and I were talking in the back about how hard that is in this town, but if you can just find that one person who will sit down with you and talk to you, they will often be able to lead you to a lot of other people. And I do that all the time. I'll sit down with somebody. I always prioritize women. I speak to everybody, but I try to prioritize women. And they'll always be like, well, where do I go? And so I always try to leave somebody with like two or three leads. Go talk to X, go talk to Y, go talk to Z. And that's what you got to do. You just got to pound the pavement and find them. And you got to think about what kind of people you need around you. Like, what are your skills? What do you think you're good at? What do you think you're not good at? Where do you think you're going to need help? And it's going to be very, very dependent on who you are, what your background is, and what you're trying to build. And if you're a 40-year-old woman trying to start a company, building a product for a 21-year-old guy, you better have some 21-year-old guys on board. And vice versa, too, because I'll tell you, I see a lot of companies where they come and pitch me, and they're like two dudes that are 25 and they're trying to pitch a tampon service. And I'm like, okay. No, I'm serious. That's a real one. I'm not kidding. It's super, super, and I think I was talking to Stacy about this before. It's super important to really have people around you. If it's not you you're building for, if you're not the primary customer, have people around you who are, whether they're on your team, ideally, or advisors, or whatever, make sure you've got people who understand the customer and know the customer problem and can help you make the right decisions.
I'll work on narrowing down my questions here for a minute. So when you look at that, the mentorship, right, and the board of advisors, what do you tell the entrepreneur who's looking to develop a board? Who's that first board member that they should be looking for?
Advisory or board?
Board. Let's go advisory board. Let's start
yeah,
there.
Advisory, I think, right, is more relevant for when you're getting
yep.
started.
Yep.
It depends on who you are and what you need. So if you've never started a company before, this is your first rodeo, you have no idea how to do it, it's often a really good idea to get somebody on your advisory board who's done it before, who knows how to raise money, who knows how to find and recruit people, who knows where to go to get legal help or accounting help or whatever help you need. So the more you can surround yourself with people who've done it before, the faster you can move. Now, that doesn't mean that the person who you have is always going to be right and already know, always have the right answer for you, but at least it gives you a perspective. And I'm a big believer in triangulation. I often like to triangulate off of two or three people. So if I'm trying to figure something new out, like right now I'm exploring VR because I'm fascinated by it and I think it's the next sea change. And so I'm constantly triangulating as I learn something new about the space. I'll go talk to one startup or some really smart guy, and then I'll go talk to somebody else and get their opinion on it because I'm building kind of a network in my head of how something should work or how something should be done. And so I always try to talk to more than one person. But if you've never done it before, find somebody who has. If you've got a product, for example, that's super heavy enterprise sales, find somebody who's done enterprise sales before. If you're building a social network, Find somebody who knows how to build social networks and who's done it and who's thought about the inner dynamics between people and all the things that happen. If you're building a marketplace, find somebody who's built a marketplace before. You know, it just depends on what you need. If you're not very technical and you've got a technical team and you're not sure what they're talking about, find somebody who can be a translation layer for you, who can talk to the techies and can help you understand, you know, call bullshit when it needs to be called, and who can look at it and help you understand risk, because risk is a big part of this. Every decision comes down to what risks are you taking. And in order to make good decisions, you have to have, you know, basic understanding of pretty much all aspects of your business.
So board's an important question. Any questions on that, or?
What do you guys want to know?
Yeah. Any board questions?
Oh, this is on the board.
You can go there too, that's fine. I have more questions, but let's hear, what do you got?
Okay, those are great questions.
Ooh, yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Go.
Okay.
It's all you.
So since I'm me, myself, and I'm my own LP, I don't have to answer to anybody else, I get to do whatever I want, which is both a good thing and a bad thing. I can get myself in trouble. So I invest in a lot of different stages. So I invest in PowerPoints, like no product, unknown team, never built anything before. That was offer up, by the way. Didn't know the
we'll
guys.
Yeah, Nick. Yeah.
Had no idea where they were from. Never heard of them before. And they didn't even have a product. They had a PowerPoint. They had a good PowerPoint, but that's all they had. I invest at way later stage as well. So it depends on the stage, what I specifically look for in terms of traction. But here's what I really look for. I look for somebody who's passionate about an idea, and I'm looking for big vision. I see way too many pitches where it's a feature, not a business. And it's like, you gotta swing for the fences. If you're gonna get into this, and you're gonna like spend all this time and energy and other people's money, you gotta freaking go for it. Yeah. And I see way too many people being timid. And there's a reason. Then they say to me, oh, well, but it's because it's too hard to raise money in this town. Okay, so that's part two of what I look for, which is have a vision, be passionate about it, and make it big. But then you got to demonstrate that you can be practical about how you approach that vision, because you can't build everything at once, no matter what it is, whether it's hardware, software, whatever. And so I look for people who can look at a big vision and say, okay, here's how I'm going to attack the problem. This is what I'm going to build first. This is what I think it's going to take. You know, this is how I think I'm going to get my first customers. So there's another example of, I hear so many pitches where people are like, and I'm going to address this market and this market and this market and this, and they're all over the place. I'm like, I head for the door. It's like, you may have a big vision where you can reach many, many markets with this vision, but you better understand where you're starting. So think big. Be super practical. That's what I look for. I obviously look for whether I think it can make money eventually, because at the end of the day, I believe that we can do a lot of good and still have for-profit companies. That's my belief. I spend more time in the for-profit world now than I do in the nonprofit world, because I got frustrated it was too slow. So you need to have a premise about how you're going to make money, and I'm going to have to believe in it. It doesn't mean you have to be making money. I invest in a lot of companies that are pre-revenue and probably won't see revenue for a while. But it depends on what it is. But I have to have a belief in the mechanism for making money eventually. And probably most important what I look for, I'm not necessarily doing this in order, it's the people. That's the number one thing, especially.
I was going to go there. I'm like, okay, what's the first thing?
Is it people?
Is it team?
Right. Well, yeah. I look at it and it's like, first of all, is this a space I'm interested in? Like, I'm not interested in gaming. So if somebody says I got a gaming company, I'm done. Like, I don't even need to ask, who are you? I'm like, I'm not going there. So if it's something that sounds kind of interesting, then I start looking really, really, really hard at the people. Who are the people? You know, and they don't have to have necessarily a big old pedigree. Stop being afraid. Just go for it. Doesn't matter, right?
It's so if you take pedigree out, then what are you going to say are some traits that you look at for that leadership?
Big vision, confidence, ability to clearly articulate, which is another big beef I have. Most of the pitches I hear are not good enough. And it's not that the people aren't good enough or that the idea isn't good enough. It's the pitch itself needs more work. And that's a huge gap in this town. We have to figure out how to get more help to early entrepreneurs, because I see so many pitches where I'm like, oh God, I love this idea, and these guys seem like they got their act together, and they look, I need to vet them, but they look pretty interesting. I think they could pull this off, but the pitch is a mess.
A mess in lack of vision or lack of communication or all the above? Like, where do you see the pitch falling down more often than not, in what category?
Boy, it falls down all over the place, but being kind of a jumble, not being very, very clear about the attack, lacking information on where the competitive threats might be. And it's not so much about dissecting every company's product that might be a competitor, but it's more about the big map of what's going on in the space. You know, like, technology's moving really fast. Customer habits are changing very rapidly. And sometimes I hear these pitches where, you know, people have their heads down and they're just like, they don't give me any sense of awareness that they understand, like, where things are going and what's going to happen. So that, they may have it, but sometimes I have to dig it out of them. They don't articulate it. And so that's one of the things that I see, too. That it's just not a clear articulation of the vision and the strategy for how to go about attacking that vision.
Questions on the pitch?
Yeah, Jim.
Well, I'm going to back up just a little bit, because you had asked the question, and I kind of have the same subject matter. So about for the advisor. So I put this out there. So my company is going to change the world, and reaching out to a local individual that was half an advisor for me and asking her, how do we get this product into, believe it or not, women's hands and let them lead it? Because everybody that I meet with in all these other countries that want a piece of it and deliver it, they're all men. But, you know, we have some really strong people locally, such as yourself and others, that want to build, you know, the dealers up as women owners. And who are those people here locally that can put it in the hands of the groups that organize that to make sure that if I'm going to go out and solicit a dealer to distribute my iPhone, how do I make sure that it's a, you know, it's a woman owner that is in the position that can take it and run with it? Because I think that in a lot of these countries, they could get it done much easier than anybody else. So I'm looking for, is there a group locally, individual advisor, or they can take your product and put it in the hands of the women out there, whether it be Africa, India, China, and have them drive?
It's hard for me to answer. I don't know if everybody heard it, but he's looking for a network. Like, he wants to put his product into the hands of women, and is there somebody here, a woman, who can get the product into the right hands? And it's really a hard question for me to answer here, because I don't understand what your product is, right? So, you know, the more I think meta topic there is, you've identified who you want to put, who your real customer is.
Not so much my customer, but the owner of the business on that side.
The distributor, well, where you need to get your product to, right? So then you have to ask yourself the question, okay, who can help me get it there? And so without knowing what it is and where it's going, I wouldn't know where to point you, but you've got the right questions. You just have to start digging around and trying to find, you know, expert in that whatever space you're in.
I'm wondering if we could raise that question up even a little bit more, Serena, in that, you know, at being Female Founders Month, like, how do the people in this room support female founders, whether that be organizations or meetups or groups or, you know, places that you could go to meet female founders? Like, what is Seattle doing and what can we do as a group to help support female founders? What might that look like?
Yes, that's a great question, and I think most all but one of the people said they were founders and not on the venture side, but there's a number of ways to support women. So, for example, one of the things that I do is I try to prioritize. I'm like, my inbox is overflowing. Don't email me because it'll be 3 weeks before I get back. I'm just telling you, it's going to be 3 weeks, right? So I try to prioritize women because often women have a harder time getting those meetings. So I make an extra effort to prioritize meetings with women and also other, you know, people of color, people who are, you know, like I've got one Hispanic guy I've been working with, you know, I'm just people who are not in the quote unquote boys club.
Yeah.
Anybody who's kind of outside of that, I try to help them first. I think more and more of the angels are in town are realizing that we're only going to support diversified companies. So if you're three white dudes that come and you're all the same age and you all went to the same university and you all look the same and talk the same and play the same games, we're probably not going to invest in you unless we can get you different. You may have a great idea, so we're going to probably work with you to try to get your company diversified. Right? So that's another way. You know, take as an angel, I'm going to take those meetings that have women in them. I mentor several angel investors who are women. Three of them just wrote their very first check in town. So that's another thing I do. And so even as founders, if you're just getting started, you probably know way more than some other women out there about something. So find other women to help.
Are there some groups, Serena, that you're a member of or that you look to, whether it be Women in Technology or I think there's Women Mobile, right, or some of the other things
that you recommend or that you're part of? Yeah, there's a bunch of groups around town that do different things. I mean, just what you're doing tonight is great. So you guys are supporting it by having Female Founders Month, like, because typically it's guys up here, right? So that's awesome. I think the more we do that, the more we can get women, because it's all about getting women connected in and getting them rolling. Right? And so there's a number of us who are, we have a women's group who's meeting for lunch trying to figure out how to do this. Like, how do we help more women? And, you know, so what I could say to you guys out there, like, what can you do, all of you, male, female, it's like, find a woman to mentor. Like, whether it's somebody who wants to be a CEO or a CMO or a CTO or an angel investor or whatever, find somebody to help. If everybody would just help one more person, we'd do way better in this town. You know, I was kind of talking to Mike earlier. It's like if I could just get a few more people who've made a ton of money in this town to actually write checks, you know, give back in terms of supporting this ecosystem, I'd be super, super happy. And there's people working on that, trying to figure out how to engage passive money in this town. Because angel investing is a ton of work, and a lot of people don't, you know, it's not what they want to do, or they don't particularly feel like they're good at it. So how can we get more of that passive money into the ecosystem to help? So everybody should be a mentor, because you got something that somebody else needs somewhere.
Oh, hey, so thank you for coming out. This is great. So you spoke about, you know, not being afraid and just going for it. However, I think that sometimes it's necessary to have a little bit of fear, a little bit of doubt, in order to, you know, drive that innovation, that creativity for your ideas. So what scared you during your time, you know, coming up and developing your companies, and, you know, what kept you up at night? What was kind of the thing, like, if I fail, shoot, this is, you know.
You got a week?
Maybe, yeah.
I'm scared shitless all the time.
What got you through it, Serena? No, like, what was
great,
the?
That's right? A great question, though.
Yeah,
it's an excellent question. You know, obviously failing is scary, right? Messing.
People are scared to fail right now, right? I know I am.
Yeah,
right.
I mean,
honestly, raise your hand, right? Like, that's always on your mind, right? As an entrepreneur, right? So that's the elephant in the room, right?
Yeah, it's. You know, that, oh my God, I'm going to mess up and this company's going to go down the tubes and my investors are going to lose all their money and my friends are going to lose their jobs and I'm such a dork. That, you know, there's that record
are
playing.
Inside my head right now? Did you know that was?
Yeah. You okay. And I are chief dorks up here right
obviously.
Now. Okay.
Yeah.
So, you know, that's one thing. You know, I mean, again, because it's Female Founder Month, I'll talk to this as a female particularly, you know, because I grew up in this industry for the last 36-ish years. I've had the record playing in my head as, you're a dumb shit, you don't know anything, go get the coffee. That's how you get treated. And so you start playing that record to yourself, oh, nobody listens to me, and all of a sudden you believe that about yourself. So on doing that record is, you know, so you get afraid to say anything because people are gonna think you're a dumb shit. So, you know, because you've kind of been told that sort of subtly. It's very subtle, it's not, these are not blatant, overt things. These are very subtle things that happen in meetings and in the hallway and in groups, you know. So So getting that record out of your head and not being afraid to open your mouth and say something is super, super important. So those are some of the things, you know, like selling my company, very, 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 very difficult sale. You know, Nokia is a big company. It was a foreign company, different culture. Anybody in the telecom space will tell you that they have they had, it's past tense, the toughest lawyers on the planet. They defend their IP portfolio vigorously. They were a nightmare to work with to get the deal done. Super hard, super scary. Because I'm like, every day I could screw this up and lose the deal. So those are the kinds of things, you know, that kept me up at night.
Yeah. So what Simon Sinek, right? What's your why, right? Like, what kept you going in all of those tough places? And maybe it's the same thing, maybe it's different, but what's your inner self-talk as an entrepreneur that keeps you going when, this is a bad day?
Yeah, no, and you'll have them. You're gonna have a lot of bad days. That's why I work on something you're really passionate about. So I'm passionate about what I do. I love what I do. I mean, sometimes I hate my days, and I hate some of the meetings I go to, but I absolutely love what I do. And the reason I love what I do is I just think I believe so much in innovation. I think there's so many things, good things. Yeah, technology can do bad things, but I'm a huge believer in technology is gonna solve a lot of big world problems. And I'm super excited to be part of that. And so every day I meet interesting new people.
Is that what gets you out of bed? Like you wake up in the morning like,
oh, yeah.
I'm solving big things.
Big problems, yeah. Right? I love working on technology. And it's the people too. I mean, every day practically I meet some new person. I'm just like, oh my God, how did I not know this person before? This person is like so cool and so interesting and so smart and so, you know, and I'm learning every day. So for me, I felt that way about my own company too when I was just focused on one thing. It's like, I am going to solve this problem. I want to solve this problem. I'm excited about this problem. But now it's, for me, it's about helping other people solve their problems and growing my portfolio. I mean, at the end of the day, I'm an investor, I have a portfolio, and so I'm measuring myself on my return, how these companies do.
Yeah, go right ahead, Steve.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah. It's been a while since I've heard that.
Oh, that's the Nokia days, right?
Yeah, Nokia, that was 07, 08, so it's been a while.
Does it ever get there? What do you think? So the question is, right, does it ever get to where you feel a little comfortable or not as stressed? Or like, how would you say that?
Something where you're more comfortable.
What do you think?
I don't know about comfort. I don't think, I get your point. I don't think comfort's the word I would use. I think you get more certainty that as you go forward that you've picked the right thing, you're onto something, customers love your product. Like at the very beginning when it's a PowerPoint, or it's on the back of a napkin, you have no idea. Like, your gut says, oh, we need XYZ product. But you don't really know until you get it out there. And that, so that's, you know, when I invest, I often write multiple checks to the same company. So the first check might be really small because it's like, well, it's a cool idea. Can these guys even build a product? They've never built anything before. Well, let's see. Oh, cool, they've built a, yeah. I mean, a lot of teams can't execute. Gotta watch for that. So can they execute rapidly, iteratively, right? Oh, they can, cool. That uncertainty's off the table, feel a little bit better. Okay, now can we get some customers? Okay, we got a few customers, what are they saying? Oh, we're starting to get some triangulation on some key points. We might be onto something. Let's see if we can 10X those customers. Oh, we were able to 10X. Maybe we really are onto something. You know, as you go along, you can build more certainty, but there's always 10 more things to be worrying about because even if you think, for example, you have product fit Now you got to start worrying about all the competitors. You got to raise money. Oh my God, how am I going to raise money? I mean, there's all, you're always got stuff to worry about. It just changes as you go along the way, what things you're worrying about. And then it gets really messy when you start having 100 employees and, you know, you're dealing with HR stuff all the time. So, you know, it just depends on where you are in the channel, you know, in the pipe.
All right, a couple more questions. Let's go here, then we'll go back to Shanika.
So you mentioned this in passing. What is your philosophy on success in the world?
That's a great question. I love that question. You're stealing the questions. That's awesome. It's great.
Well, I'm a huge advocate of Rhian Eisler, if you've ever heard of her. She runs the Center for Partnership Studies. Her seminal work was called The Chalice and the Blade. She is a cultural anthropologist, social system scientist, and basically she has reevaluated societies all the way back to the Neolithic and looked at different models for how societies work. And, you know, it's this whole question of East versus West, Black versus White, Muslim versus Christian, and she's come up with a completely different way to look at how societies operate and how to define success. And the key nugget of her work is it's not about Black versus White, East versus West, capitalist versus socialist. It's about domination versus partnership systems. And societies are that have more dominating characteristics of violence, you know, control of information, subjugation of people, no matter who it is, women, men, Black, White, whatever, don't do as well as societies that have a more partnership system, like the ancient Minoan culture, for example, or Caddo Hayek in Turkey. So there's a lot of societies over history that have been very partnership-oriented, and so there's scientists looking at those and trying to figure out how those societies operated. In our modern day, it's countries like Finland, Sweden, Denmark, that are much more partnership-oriented. So that's her first work. And her second work was about sex and the relation of sex and gender with power. Her third book was called The Real Wealth of Nations. And in that book, she talks about a completely new economic model for how to measure success in a society or in a business. And this, I would recommend every startup person should read The Real Wealth of Nations. And this is the whole point I made about the big picture earlier, because that book talks about the big picture for how we evaluate success in our society and within our companies. Like, how do you build a successful company, and what are the right measures? Because you know what? GDP is not the right measure. That's the one we typically use in this country, and that was designed for the industrial age to measure the output from factories. And what we don't measure in this society, I'll just give you one example and then I'll shut up because I could talk all day about this.
I didn't see this coming. I really didn't. I'm like, wow.
Oh, no, this is I teach
in
the high school on this topic.
Awesome.
So why is it, ask yourself this question, why is it we pay our plumbers $100 an hour and we pay our, to clean our pipes, and we pay our nannies $10 an hour to take care of our most precious asset? Why? The answer is in the book, right? And it's a long answer.
There's a cliffhanger for you right there.
The answer is in the book, and it's once you realize and you understand the dynamics, it explains why women still make 79 cents on the dollar, and you know why we have so much violence and why we have global climate change, because of the way we don't measure natural resources in the world. And if we don't start doing that, we're all gonna end up in the brink. I mean, there's things about how we measure, and measuring is really, really important. Everybody measures everything. That's how money gets distributed. That's how decisions
value,
get made.
Right, yeah.
And if we don't change the way we measure the success of our nation and of our companies, we're gonna have more and more and more problems. And that's what that book's about. And it's a framework for how I think about who I'm investing in.
So I have that. So what's a metric that you measure yourself against for success? How do you know you've been successful? And then what do you look at for a company that you want to invest in? Like, what are something that you might think like you've been successful if? So personally, and then as an angel investor, what are those two things for you?
So personally, a big thing for me is, am I really being helpful to the people that I'm advising, whether I'm sitting on
a board
or whether I'm advising formally or informally? You know, if I'm not helping, well, first of all, sometimes I'll be with a company where, okay, I can't help you guys anymore. I'm wasting your time. But at the end of the day, it's like, whoever I'm working with, I'm like, am I helping you or not? Because if I'm not, then I'm not succeeding, right? Because that's part of what I want to do. And ultimately, is the company being successful? Because if I'm successful in helping them, hopefully that's going to make the company more successful. So from a portfolio perspective, my other measurement is, how's my portfolio doing? And in the startup world, you know, it's a numbers game. You know, it's all about, you got to write enough checks, because 9 out of 10 of them are going to fail. And you hope for the big hit that will help really boost your portfolio. And, you know, if you evergreen, then it can grow your portfolio. So, you know, I'm looking for big wins. I mean, a double, a single is great, but at the end of the day, you know, I need some big wins in my portfolio to be successful.
All right, it's 8 o'clock. I want to be respectful of everybody's time. So we're going to say thank you to Serena. She'll be here to hang out for a little bit, but let's give her a huge round of applause, right? How awesome was that, right? Female Founders Month. Thank you. Awesome. So good. All
right,
so Serena will be taking some questions here.